Long before the advent of Christianity, evergreens held special meaning for people during the winter. Branches of pine and spruce and fir were hung in houses as an offering to the sun gods and to remind people of warmer days. As Christianity spread throughout Europe, the pagan tradition was absorbed into the new religion. By the 16th century in Germany, decorated trees were found in homes throughout the winter. 200 years later, Christmas trees were the rage in London during the holidays, and by the late 1800s, the Christmas tree tradition was growing in America.
Ready, Jessica?
Yes.
33.8.
And Jessica, the dendrometer band was 25 millimeters.
These researchers from Appalachian State University want to make sure there are Fraser firs still growing in North Carolina that can fill that holiday tradition for years to come.
All right. So soil moisture, 35.9.
The amount of moisture in the soil depends primarily on the type of soil. Sandy soil holds more water. Clay soil, not as much. This reading shows soil that is somewhat dry. Soil moisture is crucial to a tree's ability for transpiration, or taking in water and moving it to the limbs to evaporate. Soil moisture is also important for trees to take in nutrients for photosynthesis, or making food, and for growing. So why the concern? Well, because the planet is warming, and Fraser firs grow better in cooler and wetter climates.
And their native habitat is 5,000 feet or above, and yet all the commercial growers are 4,200 feet and below, from about 4,200 to 2,200 feet. And so since they're already growing out of their range, then if it does get warmer, then maybe the farmers at the lower elevation may start to suffer. Their trees may not be growing as well. And then the farmers up here may have to deal with warmer temperatures, and the consequences of that are not known.
Lastly, 39.1.
So researchers are using elevation as a surrogate for warming. In other words, trees growing at lower elevations where it is warmer represent trees growing in a warmer climate. Trees at middle elevations represent trees in a slightly warmer climate, and those trees at the highest elevation represent trees in a cooler climate.
As you go up in elevation, of course, it gets cooler.
Right.
We call that the adiabatic lapse rate. And so if we know the elevation of where the farms are, we can get a rough estimate on average of how much warmer it is at the low elevation, this mid elevation, and the higher elevation. Mm-hmm. But to make sure, we've also installed weather stations at each of our elevations to get the actual data. Mm-hmm. And so far we are seeing that there are large differences in temperature.
The experiment monitors Fraser firs on 6 Western Carolina tree farms at 3 different elevations. Daily weather data is continuously recorded. Then researchers spend an entire day at each farm checking how the trees are responding to current conditions.
And this has a nice airtight seal around our branch, and so that any gas that's being exchanged, we know it's just coming from whatever is inside of our cuvette here.
Scott Cory is using a portable photosynthesis system to measure how much carbon dioxide the tree is absorbing and how much oxygen and water vapor it's releasing as it utilizes the sunlight to produce food.
We want to know how much gas is being exchanged between the tree and the environment that's just in this cuvette here. So what we do is we supply a certain amount of gas into this cuvette, and then we measure the gas that's coming out of the cuvette, and we know the difference between the gas that we gave it and the gas that's coming out of the cuvette. The difference would be the rates of photosynthesis and transpiration.
So inside this box, you'll see we have a deep cycle marine battery, a whole bunch of wires, a charge controller, etc. And from this box, we have 5 wires buried going to 5 different trees. And in each tree, we have sap flow probes, and they're granular type sap flow probes. And it's 2 probes at 10 centimeters apart. And ultimately you can find out how fast sap is flowing in each of the five trees.
Measuring how fast the sap is flowing inside a tree gives an indication of how fast the tree will grow, as well as how much water the tree is using. But there's still the question of just how stressed for water a tree can be. Researchers use a small tree clipping to answer that question.
You put it in the pressure chamber, pressurize, apply a positive pressure, and when the water comes out of the cut end, you know that that positive pressure equals the negative pressure within the branch.
The higher the pressure needed to squeeze the water out of the cutting, the more stressed the tree is for water.
It's festive.
Why do you say that?
Christmas makes people happy, and so Christmas trees, you know, it's a happy thing to be around.
If all this science seems a little overwhelming in trying to understand how well a Christmas tree will grow in a warmer world, consider the tree's importance to the region. Western North Carolina is the second largest tree-growing area in the country. The industry adds about $100 million to the area's economy. So growers need to know what they must do to keep the green in evergreen.
What we're thinking is that the trees at the lower elevation, where it's warmer and drier, is that they then will have, there's a greater evaporative demand. In other words, they're going to have to put more water through the tree to keep up because the air is drier. And so we're looking to see whether they are making any anatomical changes, for example, to the wood structure where they conduct the water up the trunk. We're trying to see whether they accommodate the warmer temperatures by making the water easier to go up the trunk to get to the needles than, say, trees at higher elevation. And we're looking at the photosynthesis rates to see whether they do more photosynthesis down there because it's warmer than they do at the higher elevations. And we're also looking at changes in the length of the growing season. So trees at the lower elevation may leaf out earlier and keep photosynthesizing farther into the fall than trees at the high elevation. So even if, say, the trees were physiologically doing less well at the low elevations, if they have a longer time to do it, they might overcome that. There could be compensation. That's a possibility. I mean, we already know, for example, for Fraser firs, that it's really not possible to grow them, say, down in the Piedmont and Raleigh or Winston-Salem, where it's just too hot and dry. If it gets warmer, then the trees at the lower elevation may exceed their thermal limits. Now, we don't know that because no one has tested the thermal limits of Fraser fir yet,
right?
But that's what we're trying to investigate.